maestras fueron, son y serán. Nunca se van a quitar. Y todavía sirven, de hecho. Son para enchilar pelo, para pelo especialmente morenito. Pelo mucho, mucho, muy resistente porque su temperatura es muy fuerte. En el caso de gente latina, podría funcionar si el pelo es mucho más grueso que este. Y puede, pero tendría que tener mucho cuidado porque la temperatura es demasiado alta.
If you want, I can translate.
Yes.
Yeah. All right, so just really quick. So those are the Marcells. Those are the old school ones that we used to use back in the days. Those were one of the first ones that they started using. Those, they get heat up with the little ironing thing that's right there to be able to heat them up. They heat up to a higher temperature, and it's harder to control the temperature than the ones that you guys have nowadays where you can set the setting to it. So those were really, in reality, we still use some of them. Some people still use them, and they usually use them for hair that is really thick or really coarse, where you need a lot of heat, and if you need something that's gonna be able to actually do it. Because for example, somebody that has really thick, coarse hair, in order for them to be able to get it from curly to straighten it, then you need extra heat. You can't do it with just the regular flat iron that they use on the ones you get at Walmart or anywhere else.
I know, yeah.
Si, su modo de flow se prende el hornito y las meten ahí. Y las dejan un tiempo cuando las van a textear. Es en un papel, ¿saben? Si el papel se pone demasiado caliente, está demasiado caliente. Si nomás lo curvea, está bien, perfecto. Esto es para enchinar pelo. Agarras una sección pequeña. ¿Lo hago de qué lado? ¿Para qué
mismo? No, como quieras tú, hazla como igual. You know what, vamos. And again, remember those things, they come out in different size barrels too.
Y aquí le tuerce. ¿Sí?
So it pretty much works the same way as the other ones.
No vas a ponerlo.
Yeah. Those are really thin because they're used for short hair. So the thinner the barrel, the more you can do it for shorter hair. When you have really longer hair, you want to use a bigger barrel because what's going to happen is that the fatter the barrel, the bigger the barrel, if you, let's say, do long hair and you want to do a real thin barrel, it's going to twist so many times that the heat's not going to get all the way through to the outside. So for the ones that are bigger ones, you want to do bigger barrels to be able to get the heat from the inside to the all the way to the outside of the hair.
Y su movimiento es este aquí. Es la, no la podemos tocar porque nos vamos a quemar. Ni hay un guante todavía. Entonces aquí tenemos el control. De lo rápido, un poquito al revés. Abrimos y sacamos.
Yeah, usually your hand's going to stay like that, and what you're going to do is you're kind of twisting it around. The handles, those things turn. So they're able to turn with you as you're turning them around. Okay?
Y para planchar pelo con esta, la sección sería bien pequeña también. Estando bien caliente, metes el pelo, y lo que lo planche es la parte de atrás. Si se fijan cómo acuesto, eso sería para planchar el pelo. Metes, acuestas, y con tu mano estás estirando el pelo fuerte para plancharlo. Y queda totalmente liso.
So this is a heat comb. This is the same thing. You put it on the oven to be able to get it nice and hot. Once you get it, it's just, this one's to straighten out the hair. So people, again, that have really coarse, thick hair, curly hair, and they want to do a straightening, instead of the flat iron, they use those combs. They comb through it, and with the heat, it makes the hair flat again.
Which one?
I think it just, it's not so much of that. I think it's more, you're going to use it depending on the necessity. Because, for example, somebody that has really thick, coarse hair, you won't be able to, you do with the flat iron, it's not going to be able to do it. Like, you're going to keep doing it, and it's not going to take it. You need something that goes a lot higher with temperature to be able to get it done. So it goes more based on what client you're working with. Because if you were to do that one on somebody who has thin hair, you'll burn the hair right off like this. Like, as soon as you touch it with that comb, it just cuts through it. Yeah.
Y este es para hacer las ondas en pelo largo, más que nada. Aquí no hay pelo largo, pero voy a tratar de, sin quemar al cliente, a la clienta o cliente.
Those are used to do, it's called body waves.
Son segundos.
To be able to do where it's like wavy, more than curly.
Sí. Y suelta. Sí las marca bien, 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 bien marcadas, pero como no están calientes, y no los vamos a usar,
yeah. Those you got to make sure you do it with longer hair because you do need more space to be able to work with them since they're a bigger tool. Okay.
Exactamente. Este fueron después de esas. cuando ya había electricidad. Esas van a ser para... Okay, estas básicamente son igual, pero estas ya las usaron con heat, so estas ya las puedes usar un poquito más con nuestro pelo, un pelo que es un poquito menos resistente que un pelo más grueso. Y básicamente se utilizan igual.
So you guys, really quick, these are the Marcells as well, but these are called Marcells because they also spin the same way. So you'll see the big difference right now when we pass them around on how they feel. Again, the handle part turns as you're working with them, and you're going to be using that to flip them around in your hand as you're working with them. These came out as a second generation of the ones that you put in the oven. These are really good though, because these you can actually control the heat for people that have thin hair, to maybe damaged hair, to somebody that has regular hair. On the other ones, you can't control the heat. You put them in the oven and they're gonna get hot.
So básicamente estas, lo más difícil es saberlas girar. Es la habilidad de saberlas girar. Porque usualmente nosotros tenemos la costumbre de girarlas. So estas básicamente es, para eso esto se mueve. ¿Sí? Eso es el único diferencia.
Yeah, so these work pretty much the same as the ones that you guys clamp with, just that of course the ones you get clamped with, they're a lot easier, you know, because once you clamp it, all you do is you turn the barrel and it curls. These right here, you physically have to turn the barrel by hand.
So, a mí me gusta siempre hacerlo hacia, irlo enrollando poco a poco. So, tienes que tener siempre la habilidad de poder saber abrir y cerrar sin soltar tu cabello. Esa es la diferencia. Saberla girar sin estar utilizando los dedos para abrir y cerrar, girar, abrir y cerrar.
Yeah, ¿sí? And again, these don't have the clamps. So these right here, you're going to be able to, you're the one that's going to control whether you open it or close it and how you're turning it as well. Okay? So we'll pass these around so you guys can get the feel of it, compare it to whatever it is that you guys are using now. Any questions on this? No? So again, these are just some of the equipment that we use to be able to temporarily either straighten the hair or curl the hair. Starting from the ones that we used to use back in the days to the ones that we use now, and what are the differences between one and the other.
En estos materiales, por lo regular, siempre utilizaban dos. So mientras que usaban uno, dejaban calentando el otro.
Cool. How do you test that one?
Un poquito más rápido.
Estas
igual.
You can't use that Sinex or not?
No, I mean, you can use a paper always to be able to test the heat on it, you know. Okay. So yeah, I would recommend doing the paper heat no matter what, all the time, you know. Some people that do a lot of like hairstyling, sometimes what they do is they'll actually have like a mannequin next to them and they test it on the mannequin and see how it feels all the time, you know.
Bueno, y ahora sí vamos a hablar sobre lo que vinimos a trabajar. Va a ser el peinado con volumen en los tapers, en los fades. En la parte de arriba se usa mucho un volumen alto sin perder la conexión del peinado del taper, ¿verdad? No, porque se va a mirar mal separado lo elevado, lo peinado y el taper acá abajo. Entonces lo que yo voy a usar para dar volumen es un cepillo de paleta, cepillo redondo, un gel que no es duro, es suave, pero es un gel bueno. ¿Quieres explicar? Ok.
All right, you guys, so now we're going to go ahead and get started. We're going to be doing it's going to be more like a pompadour style. We're going to be creating volume on the top of the hair. Remember, a lot of people right now want that volume on top of their hair, and they want that style. Pompadours, comb-overs, no matter what, they want to create some kind of a volume on top. You know, nobody really wants flat hair anymore, whether it's texturized or just the way they style it, you know, but everybody wants some kind of a hairstyle. And to be honest with you guys, right now at the barbershops, if you're not blow drying and you're not styling, a lot of clients are walking away, you know, because another barber is doing it. So you guys got to make sure you learn how to do some good volume, some good styling, because nowadays people don't want just a haircut. They want something where they're going to walk out with a style. You know, we're not charging $7-$8 like back in the days for a fade. We're charging $20-$25 for a haircut, but we are including a style.
Okay, aquí le pregunté a él que si quería algún estilo en especial, le dijo que lo que yo quisiera hacer. Revisé su pelo y a los dos lados tiene desconexión. el arriba es largo y a los dos lados está corto. Pues voy a peinarlo hacia atrás, pero un poquito cargado hacia un lado, como si fuera un comb over. Y le voy a separar un poco el pelo aquí en medio. Pero acá atrás, igual va a tener conexión. No va a estar nada separado. Va a tener volumen y va a quedar todo parejito.
So on the top, we're going to create volume. It's going to be kind of like a pompadour, but he wants it to go to the side a little bit. So it's kind of like a mixture between a pompadour and a comb over. You know, it's still going to be pushed to the back. He's still going to connect it and blend it into the sides, but he doesn't want a straight pompadour going to the back.
Para esto, el pelo tiene que estar totalmente limpio, o si es que ya trae algún producto, el producto no debe ser antes. Al principio debe ser un producto que sea un poquito pegajoso, que no tenga nada de grasa. No debe de tener pomada o wax, porque no va a dejar que eleve el pelo.
When you guys do somebody's haircut, make sure that if they come in with gel, they come in with hairspray or any kind of product, try to do a shampoo or wash it off to be able to get rid of whatever product they have on the hair. Because if they have product on the hair, sometimes when you start blow drying it, it's going to create residue too. So it's not going to give you a nice clean shape.
Entonces, como su pelo ya venía limpio, solo lo humedezco.
His hair was already clean, so este we're only going to wet it a little bit.
Este gel yo lo uso para cortar pelo, porque cuando se seca ese gel, tocas tu pelo y es como si no te hubieras puesto nada.
So es bien, bien ligero.
Bien demasiado. Yeah.
So the gel that he's using is very light. It doesn't have a strong hold. He said he likes it because when he applies it, he can blow dry on top of it. Once he gets it nice and blow dry, that it doesn't leave anything. It doesn't feel sticky because it's very light.
It's light, but does it still hold its shape? So that way you
can... No, he uses it mostly for volume. Because what happens is that the gel, when it's very light, it'll still give you a little bit of lift, but it won't control the hair. Whatever product he puts in at the end will control the hair.
And that's why he uses the gel and oil?
Yeah. Yeah. And usually that's what the most pompadours, more styles, you'll notice that they'll do that. What they do is they first start off with a light application of something, create the blow dry, create the volume. Once they have the volume, then they work on the style. Yeah.
What's the name of the gel you use?
It's the Johnny B gel.
How do you think?
This one here. You know. ¿Lo ocupas o lo puedo pasar?
Sí. Lo voy a empezar y voy a retirarle un poquito lo más humedad que se pueda sin secarlo totalmente. Y aquí le vamos a dar movimiento para todos lados para que lo seque más rápido.
A ver la brocha que está usando. La brocha. So this is the brush that we're using. ¿Por qué usas esta brocha?
Ah, para controlar todo el pelo. Y nada más para medio secarlo.
Okay. So that one, they're using it, we use it a lot. Well, he uses a lot to blow dry the hair because they create volume, but it doesn't pull the hair. He's gonna dry it, but he's not gonna completely dry the hair. He's gonna leave it a little bit moist. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, because you want to style it to the finished haircut.
So,
yeah, I would suggest, yeah, like if a lot of people, sometimes like they have really thick hair in order for you to control it, because the minute you put anything on a person that has thick hair, it's going to keep falling because it has a lot of weight. So you want to kind of use your finisher to remove a little bit of the weight so you can be able to create a lift and volume. And we'll go over some finisher techniques and stuff like that. So we actually have two people that are coming in 2 weeks as well. They're going to be showing you guys how to do a lot of texturizing and volunteering. So.
Okay, aquí el pelo ya se está secando. Ahí paro de usar este cepillo. Y me voy con uno pequeño redondo.
So once he dried a big portion of it, now he's going to switch on brushes to a smaller bristle one. This one is going to be starting to create the volume. The other one was just to dry it. This one's to create volume.
Empieza El aire es caliente, totalmente caliente, pero no lo acerco mucho.
The hair, the dryer is set at deep, so it is pretty warm air, so it's not colder, it's hotter.
Ya cuando yo siento que está seco lo que estoy cepillando, le acerco el aire caliente y lo retiro. Y suelto. Ahí no subo, más arriba.
Once he feels that the hair is getting pretty dry, then he'll put the dryer a little bit close to give it a quick hit, and then he'll move it away. And then he'll move up to a higher section. Remember, when you guys have the blow dryer on heat, movement.
Puedes darle aire frío con este. O nomás elévalo, así caliente, eleva el aire, la secadora hacia arriba. Cuando a él le llega, ya le llega frío. Queda levantado el tema.
So one of the things that people do, and almost everybody that does for volume or hairstyles, what they do, is they'll hit it with the heat, and then when they're done, they'll hit it with the cold air, so that the cold air will keep the shape that you're doing. It kind of makes it stiff again, like it holds it. So it's hot air to push it up, and then cold air to keep it there. And you'll see that it starts creating volume already. So again, he's doing it with the hot air, creating the volume, a blast of cold air at the end to keep the volume up.
Tenemos que agarrar secciones a lo grueso del círculo este, no de este de afuera. De este círculo es el importante.
We're doing about 1-inch section. So he usually goes by the base, the barrel of the comb. Not the bristles, but the barrel.
Es lo mismo que cuando hacen el enchilado en el termo. Es a lo grueso de la tenaza, ¿verdad? La sección que agarra.
Sí.
Es lo mismo.
En la cámara no se vio, no importa. You can already see a lot of like the volume, look. What do you mean by teaser?
I said the tease.
Yeah, you could, but
for women or what?
It's just the tease, they usually use it for like specific styles. Like for example, they want that big pump right here in the front. They'll tease the bottom part of it, and then they grab the hair and they put it on top of it. So the tease is just kind of pushes the hair up. For this one, I think it'll be harder because you don't have a lot of space to feed and then cover on top.
Ya en lo que es acercándose un poco a la frente, peinamos hacia arriba. Thank you.
He usually starts off in the back section so that when he gets to the front, he can focus a lot more on the sliding and stuff. On the back, he's just creating volume, volume, volume.
Ese pillo ahí quieto, le echamos aire caliente, retiramos para que eche aire frío.
So what he's doing is he puts it, he rolls it, rolls it, rolls it, then he holds it in place with the hair wrapped around it, throws heat on it to create it, and then throws a blast of cold air. And that's how you're going to be able to create that really big volume.
Esta parte ya está más alta. Ocupamos algo más grande, cepillo más grande.
This section,
lo podemos calentar el cepillo antes de ponerlo ahí para que sea más pronto.
This section is longer and it's going to go higher, so he's going to switch over brushes to a bigger brush, because remember, the more longer the hair, the bigger the brush you're going to be using. That brush is metal in the middle, so what he was doing is he was heating up the metal part before he used it to roll it, because that helps with the heat. Like that right there, the metal part that's holding the hair is already really hot because he warmed it up. No, because yeah, it's faster. If you have the metal's already warm, it's like you're using the heat already that's in it. So you're kind of like doing double heat. You're doing the metal, the heat that's in the middle, plus the heat that you're throwing as you're working it.
Si yo no le hubiera puesto el gel y hubiera dado volumen nada más con su pelo limpio, no iba a hacer que el pelo se quedara parado. Se elevaba, pero en cuanto quitara yo el cepillo, se iba a acostar ondulado.
If he were not using the gel, he would have been able to do a little bit of styling, but the minute he removed the comb, it wouldn't hold. It would have just fell back again. Because his hair is so long that it can't hold just by itself, even with the broken. There's that little bit of holding in here. Yeah. It's very light. And again, that's why you don't see a lot of residue on the top too. Because if it was like really thick gel, you would see a lot of residue on there. Like me myself, instead of gel, I like to use, Gentleman Republic has this very light pomade. It's called Classic. So it's a very light pomade, and I use it that instead of the gel, and it gives you the same thing. You blow dry it, it doesn't leave residue, and it helps you with the lift as well. So you can work, yeah, the pomade, yeah. No, we use the stiff. No, it's the same thing as the stiff, but it's a Classic, so it's lighter. Yeah. Pomade is more for molding. Gel is a stronger hold, and then pomade, you apply it and you can reshape it. Gel, once you put it on and it dries, that's where it stays.
And no matter what, like, pomade,
you can readjust it. Because it won't, and pomade shouldn't, you know, dry up. Pomade should be always a little sticky so you can reshape it. You guys can see how much volume it has.
Lo quiere mantener con movimiento su pelo o lo quiere tener fijo todo el día. Si va a hacer un evento, lo puedes tener fijo sin que se mueva y todo el peinado lo va a tener todo su evento.
At this point, you want to ask your client if they want something where they're going to, let's say they might be going to an event or a wedding or something, and they want the hairstyle to stay like that the whole day, you'll know what products you're going to be using, meaning like harder, stronger hold. If they want something where it's more flexible, they like it to come out like that, but they want it to be a little bit of flexible, you'll use less, harder, stronger products.
Okay, si lo vamos a... Voy a hacer los dos al mismo tiempo. Primero lo voy a hacer fijo, y después lo voy a hacer con movimiento.
We're going to start off with a little bit of a stronger hold, like if he was going to keep the comb, the style of the whole day.
Para mantenerlo fijo, tienes que abrir el pelo desde el centro. A ver si un poquito. Mira, hay que chequear bien porque aquí está húmedo todavía.
you want to make sure that the hair is wet, not completely dry. So when he was doing right now, before he sprayed it, he ran his fingers through the hair. He noticed it was still a little damp inside. If the hair is a little wet, remember it lowers the strength of anything that you put on it. And usually what he's going to do, he's going to start applying it, but he's going to apply it from the inside out. So he's not going to really coat the outside yet. He's going to go on the inside. This is to be able to get that root.
Y lo vas acomodando poco a poco.
Because if you only apply it on the top part, the roots don't have strength.
So it's like working the supporting muscle.
Yes. We're doing the structure of it pretty much, you know. And notice the comb that he's using is not something that has the teeth very tight in. It's not going to take away the volume. If you guys use a regular all-purpose comb, it's going to pull the hair and it's going to take away all the volume that you've been working on.
So just in case you don't have that comb, you go, it's just like the rat tail, the point of it, and just like...
Yeah, it just takes longer though, because you're only going to have one little stick to be going through it, you know? So we always recommend you guys to have either one of these or to have the chemical combs. The chemical combs, also they're combs, but the teeth are really separated. They're very white tooth combs.
Dos palabras. María, no tenemos un peine de químico. Chequea allá atrás, donde está la cajita de todos los peines. Ahí hay peines, se ve que hay peines como para químicos, que son bien separados los dientes.
And Gabriel sells those combs too, the styling combs with the really separated teeth.
Fish combs, right?
Once he got that inside part of it, now he's gonna go ahead and style the outside of it. And again, you don't want to apply too much pressure into it. You don't want to take off all the work that you put into it.
Is that like the Pacino's thing, where you use that Pacino's comb?
Yeah, it's the same thing. All those combs started off as chemical combs. And then from there, people started using them out of the other stuff, and they call it a styling comb. They called it, you know, the five-finger comb. I've heard people call it five-finger comb. It looks like your five fingers ran through your hair. You know, so people started creating their own thing. But in reality, they all started as chemical combs.
Just use that one.
Y para que aquí arriba no se mire disparejo, vas a poner tu mano aquí. Y solo este vas a...
And just so that it looks nice and even on the top section, what he's doing is he's pulling the hair to make sure that all the hairs are being pulled down so that there's no hair tangled inside of it. And he's using the rat tail comb to be able to get that hair nice out. And he's using the top of the hair, the other hand, to be able to make it nice and flat.
Ahora, vamos al frente. Hay que cerrarle todo el pelo abierto que está al frente.
Okay. So these are all like chemical combs, or, you know, they use them. This one's right here, the original chemical combs. So you can see the teeth, the same thing. They would work also to be able to separate it without getting rid of the volume. Okay. And again, espérame, Carlos, un ratito, ¿no? These right here, they're called chemical combs. The reason for that is because when we do the chemical relaxer, we want to place the hair into a straining position without pulling it, because the chemical relaxer is a very strong chemical. So if you were to use, like, somebody has curly hair, you apply a chemical relaxer on it, you're going to be called, it's called a smoothing technique. You put comb it with these so that it goes into a flat shape, and it keeps that shape without pulling the hair. Because the chemical relaxer is, I always tell people, just think of it, a chemical relaxer is the same chemical that they use for what? Anybody know? For Drano, right? So it's that strong that people use chemical relaxers. It's the same chemical as Drano. It's like you're putting Drano on the hair to be able to chemically change the shape of it.
Y para cerrar la parte en la frente, otra vez acercamos el spray. Y con la parte finita del peine.
On the front section, what we're doing is, what Carlos is doing is he's removing the spacing that he had on the front. He wants to make it nice and it looks flat. You see the big difference? This is when you guys see those Photoshop pictures. This is all the process that the barbers go through to get that perfect picture. You guys follow Sky Salon? That guy, every haircut he does, he styles it just like this or better. You know, if you guys don't follow him, go on Instagram, follow Sky Salon. That guy's ridiculous on his hairstyles. And that was funny because I remember when I first started doing it, he used to put in like really nice pictures, but he wasn't that big. Little by little, as the hairstyle is getting more familiar and more popular, now he works for the major companies. Like, he has his platform artists everywhere all around the world. He does classes everywhere. Like, they're sold out. Like, you know, but it was consistency. He kept putting those pictures out there, you know, of his work.
When you go to conventions, you don't have to do like shapes and designs. You can do stuff like this.
Yeah.
And still win.
Yeah. A lot of people, that's what they grade on too. You know, when you go to conventions, when you go to barber battle competitions, sometimes a lot of the points is styling at the end. Because you could do a really good fade, he could do a really good fade. But if you can style it and he can, you got it. You know?
Aquí me voy a meter un poquito en problemas con los que cortamos pelo. Y me incluyo yo también. Cuando cortamos pelo debemos usar de guía la parte del frente si queremos que todo el corte se mire parejo. El peinado. Una cosa es el peinado, otra cosa es el corte. Aquí el corte está parejo, es por eso que aquí se ve alto. Si se corta aquí al frente y se usa este pelo de guía hacia atrás, el peinado hubiera quedado totalmente parejito. Pero como no está y tengo que hacerlo, hay que bajarle aquí y elevarle acá.
So this is where, again, we're talking about the hair cutting structures. His hair, he can tell right now that when as he's combing it, that the front part might be even a little bit shorter than the back part. So he's having problems now doing the hairstyle because the structure of it is not where it's supposed to be at. When you use the front guide to be able to blend in as you're cutting to the back, then it should all blend in even. But for example, with him is once he lifted this part, you see this right here, is a lot longer and it's sticking up a lot. So now with the comb, he's trying to like lift it, bring it back down so that it blends in as much as possible.
What's a bad haircut on the top?
No, it's just maybe the style that the way they cut it, you know? Everybody cuts different styles, you know?
Why would the back be longer than the front? Because he doesn't comb his hair like that. It's normally, he's going to just cut it the way that he combs it.
Y es importante usar el espejo para asegurarnos que aún en el peinado dejamos derecha la imagen de nuestro modelo, porque si lo peinamos chueco, aún el corte se va a ver chueco.
You guys always use the mirror to be able to look at it, look at the shape, look at the silhouette, look at maybe all the angles. The mirror really shows you a whole different section of your haircut. And again, you're gonna work around angles. Turn him, that's a good thing that we have chairs that turn, because you can turn him around and be able to work with whatever it is that needs to get done.
Si no podemos cerrar, tenemos que abrir. Aquí, si se fijan de allá ustedes, aquí está abierto. Esta área de pelo, ¿sí? Aquí está cerrado. O lo cierro desde atrás. Pero mira, si yo me fijo, el corte aquí está. Aquí hay pelo largo y aquí el pelo está corto. Yo no puedo hacer nada más que tratar de cerrarlo lo más que se pueda. Porque aquí no tengo con qué abrir.
Right there, he's just doing little details, you know, getting the sides in as much as possible. But I think it looks really good. What do you guys think?
I think it looks good too.
Ese sería con que lo puedo fijar más, pero como sé que lo vamos a mover, lo puedo dejar más fijo, que no se mueva totalmente nada de todos lados.
A ver, Carlin.
Sonríele. A la cámara.
All right, you guys, give him a round of applause. Gracias, Carlos.